Hello. How do you choose a tire without the luxury of buying them all? Hey, Bridgestone. No, there is a way from a distance to choose not only a correct tire, but the best tire for your bike. Let me show you how. Carcass compound tread. Most of us have dogs that could name three parts of a tire, but if you understand what these do, you'll find the secret combination of a quality choice. Now let's make like vultures and start with the carcass. All tires have fibers that stretch from one bead up the sidewall, across the tread, and down to the other bead. But there are a couple ways to do this. One method is to layer a shit ton of plies across each other. Bias ply tires are simple and strong. You consider them for something like this Bridgestone Adventure Cross AX41. I'm gonna load it up with 100 pounds of travel kit, ride it across razor rocks without getting punctures, air it down to 20 PSI, then jump it and hope this super strong sidewall is enough to stop my rim from dinging in the ground. Bias ply sounds great. The chicken can also cross the road straight from one bead to the other. Let's say we use only a few strips of fabric and then reinforce just the tread part with some steel belts. Well, this would be a lot lighter, so my suspension will have an easier time keeping the tire gripping against the ground. A few strips of steel shed heat a lot faster than a million layers of fabric, so hot sport tires like a Bridgestone S22, Pirelli Angel GT2, or even this Michelin Anarchy Adventure, which is made for off-roaders who like to carve on the pavement, well, they should all be radial ply. Wow, bias or radial, that narrows my choice to a few thousand tires. Not very helpful. But check this. Radial tires' steel belts, which you might also find on bias tires if they're called bias belted, well, these can be tuned. Case in point, the Pirelli Angel GT2. Now, 6 years ago, this was a half-ass sport touring tire, kind of like a Panigale with a Panier, a fast, but not very touring. However, Pirelli took the Gran Turismo name more seriously with Gen 2, and in that case, variable belt tensioning is what we want to see. This profile is inherently strong here, at the crux of the curve, and here, where it's reinforced by the sidewall. But mid-lean contact patches are weaker. They tend to pucker away and create uneven pressure, uneven wear. Ah, that's a big deal. Gone are the days when you needed to be Kenny Roberts to abuse a tire. Modern sport tours make 200 horsepower, and any ham-fisted idiot can push their rubber to the limit of traction, then back again as many times per second as their traction control allows. So we love tires with variable belt tension like the Angel GT. They're tighter in some spots, looser in others, to perfectly counteract the common wear patterns of modern monster sport tours. Last thing to say about carcasses is that each has a hard limit. For radials, they are almost always limited to tubeless. Few and flexible plies means there's an undercoating. That undercoating rubs really hot against tubes and kapoof. There are exceptions like this Anarchy Adventure, which is specially designed to take tubes. So your trailside guy with a sidewall cut can throw a tube in and get back home again. But generally, your off-road and your vintage folks will need a tube in one hand, so with their other, they'll show their favorite finger to radials. Bias ply's hard limit is to do with sizing. You're using one method to make the tread and the sidewall, so you get stuck with sidewalls about as tall as the tread is wide.
If you do most of your riding in the early 2000s on ultra-wide, ultra-low-profile rubber, you will be shunned by bias plies.
So as consumers, we seek products like this Avon Cobra Chrome. It's a cruiser tire, but it digs how diverse cruisers are. Nimble sportsters want a short radial sidewall that won't squirm on the gas coming out of a corner. They value this wear-away snakeskin edge that proves they've been riding to the limit. But big touring tankers need as much bias-belted burliness as they can get, and they value flame grooves that never quite lick the center contact patch, so pesky cops with their tread depth indicators won't have anything to measure. Avon gets the various needs, so they used every construction imaginable to offer 68 sizes on this tire, 14 white walls, bias belted, radial. No one is left out by Cobra Chromes. Compound. Usually manufacturers will brag about having silica in the mix. Why is that good? Is it even good? This is hugely misunderstood. Silica does two things. First, understand that tires undergo a rapid behavioral change at cold temperatures. The rubber is warm and soft and pliable, and then all of a sudden it's a cold, hard bitch. This transition usually takes place around 7 degrees Celsius. Be careful riding below that. But silica pushes this edge even lower. So if you ride a lot in cold and wet climbs, yes, more silica is safer. The other thing silica plays with is mileage. See, as a tire rolls, it deforms macroscopically, and this contact patch has to flatten once per rotation. On a 24-inch wheel doing 60 kph, that's like 10 compressions a second. And the energy those take is what we call rolling resistance. But microscopically, if we zoom into this contact patch on a rough road, the rubber's also deforming here and 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 here until it leaves the pavement again. That is very high frequency compression. And the energy these take is what we call grip. So in rubber, you can use something sticky like carbon black, which has high rolling resistance, but also very high grip. Or you could use something hard as a filler like plastic that has low rolling resistance, but very low grip. Or you use something special, like silica, which loses low energy at low frequency, but high energy at high frequency, aka very excellent mileage, equally excellent grip. This is the best of both worlds for most of us, unless you are exceptionally fast or exceptionally cheap. However, don't let manufacturers charm you into thinking a silica tire is worth your spare kidney. It's not. It's two of the most common elements on Earth, and any moron can dumbly dump silica into the melting pot. What is special is when a manufacturer applies silica in strategically separate concentrations. This Angel GT2 has more silica in the center, so it rolls durably, fuel efficiently, safely, when you're scared straight upright in a rainstorm. But the ratio tips away from silica and towards sticky carbon black near the edges for when you want to get goofy in the canyons. That's good. But we look for something better in a fast adventure tire. See, broken up treads have an inherent disadvantage, lack of rigidity. They wander like a big drunk on a small boat, especially at the edge of grip. So we like this Anarchy Adventure because it has what Michelin calls 2 Compound Plus. There's hard rubber and soft rubber, like before, but this time the hard center extends underneath the soft sides. We look for this on blocky tread patterns because it makes the otherwise loose corners feel sturdier. My complaint is that Michelin only spent money doing this to the rear. The front sides are pure soft, a little too soft. If you break hard into corners, you'll find yourself killing Anarchy Adventure front tires as quickly as you wear through rears. Now, from a super sport tire, we seek something different yet. Continental uses one compound, the grippiest of grip all over. They managed to cure it differently across the profile, so it's slightly harder up top, slightly tackier down low, but there's no hard ledge where that transition happens. It's a continuous gradient of extremely predictable traction. In my opinion, there's no better tire to push to the absolute limit. In Continental race attacks, for the track. Race attack endurance, if you need to log a few miles getting there. Sport attacks, if it's a lot of miles getting there. Slicks, if you race. Rain specials, if you really race. SM, if you have a supermoto. I love Continentals for going really fast. Before we move away from compounds, I'll briefly mention the S22. No fancy continuous curing, but Bridgestone did shell out for 5 layers of silica. That's decently specialized performance. You still get some thin strip of practicality. In fact, they went for an ultra fine grain silica this year to increase the silicated surface area without actually increasing the surface area of that center strip. More mileage. It pains me to say that this is the smart choice for a supersport tire. Now, Rossi would shave seconds on my beloved Continentals, but the Bridgestone lasts three times as long, costs half as much, is safer in inclement weather. Let's be real. If I'm gonna get faster, I have a million bad habits that cost me more time than whatever small sacrifices Bridgestone made with the S22.
This is usually the right answer for sport bikes. That's why so many wear them off the factory line.
Tread patterns. Our final and most important lesson, because no one can choose this for you. And the best tread is one that's matched to the specific surface you ride. Take the extremes. A perfectly hard surface is matched to a perfectly flat slick. All the grip comes from this parallel rubber, so we might as well maximize that. On the other hand, a perfectly soft surface, like sand, is matched to a paddle tire. And the forward push comes from these perpendicular surfaces digging in, so we maximize those. You could say that every tread pattern is just some combination of these two things. The Dunlop D952 is a great example, and coincidentally my favorite dirt bike tire because I get to pick this shit. It's made for soft and hard terrain, it's super long lasting compared to the Geomaxes, and it's super cheap, like 30 bucks cheaper. Anyway, see that the center knobs form paddles, but they're not too far apart. And that means we have enough top surface for grip on hard terrain, and sharing the load across that surface area means we're less likely to chunk the tire. If you take a paddly soft terrain tread on rocky sections, you're liable to rip knobs right off if they're not supported by enough of their friends.
To that effect, we have edge knobs for digging the bike sideways into a berm, but they're bridged to their neighbors for strength on hardpack. You should look for this technique on any good off-road tire, even adventure tires like the 4060 AX41, up to the 8020 Anarchy Adventure.
Now this is something people get hung up on for no reason. Do I ride 80% of the time on-road and 20% off? Or is it more like a mileage mix, or just what I like more? Personally, I don't dick around with needless numbers. On an adventure bike, you just need blocks or knobs. A block pattern is for the folks that explore fire roads. This is great on gravel, and the key is that you actually have individual tread blocks. In a pinch, I can air this down to get out of a sticky spot, provided it isn't wet.
Companies will try to market grooved tires for ADV bikes like the 9010 Conti Trails or Pilot Trails, but honestly, at that point you might as well buy any street tire.
Now if you take your bike into trails, sand pits, mud bogs, you need knobs with large voids in between so the dirt can fling out. This is almost invariably called a 40-60 tire, and sometimes 50-50 if there's a smooth center bend just to be a little longer and quieter on the highway. Otherwise, this design is loud as hell. So, get blocks or knobs. 80-20, 40-60. 15,000 kilometers, 7,500. Going further to the pavement, further to the dirt, or into the gray area in between doesn't make a lot of sense to me.
Knobs are not just knobs, mind you. Clever ones, like on the D952, are slightly wider at the base for added strength. The AX41 has knobs that are wider and taller on the leading edge to spread the load and slow down wear.
Like a dog in its teeth, off-road tires only live as long as their tread stays sharp. Once these edges start to round off, the traction goes downhill fast. The pitch of a knob is another effective way to combat degradation. It should be steeper on the leading edge so it doesn't deform so extremely under braking. Because of this, the AX41 wears more evenly than its competitors, K60s, TKC80s, E805s, E07s, Anarchy Wilds. They all get a bit wavy. We're pretty much done because the exact same principles echo for street tires, just at lower volume. If you look close, the leading edge of a tread groove should be angled away from the direction of travel so it pushes upright under braking. On a rear tire, you should find the opposite, so it pushes square under acceleration.
In the same way, we want grooves with gradually shallowed edges. This works just like the reinforcement bridges we saw between knobbies. By joining two edges together, the groove resists folding in on itself. The main difference is that dirt treads move chunky earth, while street treads move thin water. So on road tires, we'll want to see thinner voids that pull water away from the contact patch and prevent hydroplaning.
Last thing to mention is profile. Making a round tire is easy, but not that useful. A quality choice will be multi-radius, meaning it's flatter on top and steeper on the sides, or steeper on top and then flatter on the sides. The former excels on something like the AX41. This flat top spreads the load to improve mileage on an otherwise short-lived tire. Not so much cornering grip, but hey, it's 45 minutes of Trans-Canada Highway between here and the trailhead. I wasn't planning on taking it knee down. If you do want to go faster, choose a sharper profile. The Adventure Cross, Angel GT2, and S22 are all skinnier on top to decrease rolling resistance and encourage the tire to tip in, finding there a larger, relatively flat cornering patch. Whew, now we understand how carcass, compound, and tread work for us, so we can look at a tire and know if it's an optimal choice. Of course, my head hurts from analyzing all that stuff, so if you just need a break, all these specimens I used are guaranteed brilliant examples of what we just learned. Bye-bye. Oh.
First shot. Hey.